subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Lipakshi Khurana. Here are the top stories we're tracking for you on Friday, the 22nd of October. Indian Prime Minister Modi says economy getting boost from rising COVID-19 vaccinations. Protest held across the world to observe Black Day of Pakistani atrocities in Kashmir. And for Hazara community in Afghanistan, where to pray can be life and death choice post recent attacks. And now for all the details. As India breached the landmark of administering 1 billion COVID-19 vaccine doses, Prime Minister Narendra Modi said on Friday that economic growth was getting a boost from rising vaccinations across the country and urged the citizens to purchase locally manufactured products over the upcoming festive season. He also urged people to follow COVID-19 appropriate behavior during the festive season.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, while addressing the nation after the country's milestone of 1 billion vaccination on Friday, said that economic growth was getting a boost from rising vaccinations across the country and urged citizens to purchase locally manufactured products over the upcoming festive season. India's immunization campaign hit a milestone of 1 billion vaccinations on Thursday. The country has covered three quarters of its 944 million adults with at least one dose, but only 31% with two. Hailing the achievement, PM said India's vaccination program was science-born, science-driven and science-based. He also called for vigilance against COVID-19 and recommended wearing masks during festivals.
Vaccine ke badhte hue coverage ke saath saath aarthik samajik gatividhiyan ho, खेल जगत हो, टूरिज्म हो, एंटरटेनमेंट हो, सब तरफ सकारात्मक गतिविधियां तेज हो रही हैं। आने वाले त्योहारों का मौसम इसे और गति देगा, और शक्ति देगा।
India has so far reported 34.1 million COVID-19 cases and more than 452,000 deaths, most during a second wave of infections of the Delta variant between April and May.
Massive protests were held across Pakistan-administered Kashmir, Bangladesh and other parts of the world to observe October 22nd as Black Day to condemn the brutal raid of Jammu and Kashmir by Pakistan in 1947. The protesters demanded an unconditional apology from Islamabad for its acts of atrocities and demanded it to immediately leave its occupied territories.
Massive anti-Pakistan protests and a candlelight vigil were held across Pakistan-administered Kashmir on Friday to observe October 22 as Black Day to highlight Pakistan's role in raids in Jammu and Kashmir in the year 1947, which brought in its wake horrifying stories of mass plunder, killings and vandalism. On the fateful day in 1947, nearly 10,000 tribesmen backed by Pakistan Army invaded Kashmir to occupy it by force. The invasion resulted in nearly a third of the territory now known as Pakistan-administered Kashmir falling to the raiders. Consequently, Indian troops were airlifted to Kashmir on October 26 and they succeeded in blocking the raiders' advance. People in the illegally occupied region have over the years blamed that they are denied basic fundamental rights and are meted out with severe brutality for voicing their concerns. Meanwhile, similar demonstrations were also organized in Bangladesh and Japan to mark the Black Day. The event in Dhaka drew parallel to the 1971 genocide by Pakistan Army in Bangladesh. The protesters demanded an unconditional apology from Islamabad for its acts of atrocities and demanded the Pakistani establishment to immediately leave its occupied territories.
The Financial Action Task Force has yet again retained Pakistan in its grey list, observing that it needs to further demonstrate actions against UN-designated terror groups, which include Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Taliban. The watchdog also expressed concern about the current and evolving money laundering and terror financing risk environment in Pakistan's neighbouring Taliban-controlled Afghanistan.
The president of FATF, the Financial Action Task Force, Marcus Player, in a virtual press conference from Paris on Thursday, announced that Pakistan will remain on the watchdog's grey list and ask it address its strategically important deficiencies. The terror financing watchdog said Pakistan has to demonstrate that it has taken action and effectively prosecuted UN-designated terror outfits, which include Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed and the Taliban. It has also expressed its concern about the current and evolving money laundering and terrorist financing risk environment in Taliban-controlled Afghanistan.
Pakistan remains under increased monitoring. The Pakistan government has two concurrent action plans with a total of 34 action plan items. It has now addressed or largely addressed 30 of the items. Its most recent action plan from June this year, which largely focused on money laundering deficiencies, was issued after FATF's regional partner, APG, the Asian Pacific Group, identified a number of serious issues.
This comes as Pakistan's Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi held talks with top Taliban leadership on Thursday for the first time since the militant group took control of Afghanistan. Although Pakistan has not formally recognized the Taliban government, it has indicated support to unfreeze their assets abroad. This also comes after a recent spate in activities of Pakistan-based terror outfits in India's Jammu and Kashmir, including killings of civilians, which have highlighted India's concerns over cross-border terrorism from Pakistan.
A wave of recent attacks in Afghanistan, predominantly on Shiite Hazara ethnicity, has left many in the community fearing for their lives every time they leave home. The last two Fridays have seen suicide bombings at mosques, both attacks claimed by Islamic State and both targeting the minority Shiite sect. In the wake of the violence, some Hazaras are not going to the mosque at all.
The Hazaras, a predominantly Shiite community, have been at the receiving end of some of the most violent attacks in Afghanistan's history. Many have been killed in suicide attacks, that they have a special graveyard in capital Kabul called the Garden of the Martyrs. Most of those killed in a May school bombing, mainly girls, were laid to rest here. For Asif Lali, who lost his younger brother in one of the recent attacks on his community, the predominantly Shiite Hazara ethnicity has him fearing for his life every time he leaves his home. He has even stopped going to Friday prayers.
As har lahaz mo tars mikhrem hatto ma sarak miram as pas kucha ha miram tars daram da sarak ha koshish mikrem as kucha ha farayi ubur konum va khater ki ek tars sar vujud mo amada ki har lahza de fikr mikrem ki shayad ek intihari shavad da har joy ki ek robandan misha trafik ziyad misha ek dilhora ba ma paida mishe ki khodai nakhaste ek amali intihari da inja nashe chun mardum mo waqan da zer tahdid hamalat daish ast.
The last two Fridays have seen suicide bombings at mosque, both attacks claimed by Islamic State and both targeting the minority Shiite sect. More than 100 people were killed in total.
Our community feel that in the future Friday, for example, 2 days or 3 days later, maybe Herat will explode, maybe Kabul will explode, maybe some other, for example, Helmand or other places or mosques which Shias are coming for the Jummah, praying.
Taliban authorities pledged to step up security at Shiite mosque last week, but few in the community have much faith in a movement long seen as their enemy. Both the Taliban and Islamic State are Sunni. Thousands of Hazaras died under the last Taliban government from 1996 to 2001. But it was the appearance of Islamic State in Afghanistan that made the Shiites a systematic target. The Persian-speaking Hazara are thought to trace their descent back to the armies of 13th century Mongol conqueror Genghis Khan and are considered the third largest ethnic group in Afghanistan, behind the Pashtuns and Tajiks.
And in news from Nepal, the death toll from landslides and flash floods triggered by days of unseasonal rains in various parts of Nepal has reached at least 101, while 41 people are still missing, authorities said. Nepal's Interior Ministry on Thursday confirmed that 101 people died in the disaster. Till Thursday, as many as 2,232 houses were inundated due to the floods. Rescue workers are working across the country to rescue and shift those at risk of floods and landslides to safer places. The security personnel are also clearing roadblocks in different parts of the country. The untimely rain, which started on Sunday, has begun to recede in most parts of the nation. Thousands of farmers in affected region are staring at the prospect of ruin. Just as the paddy was ripening, the crop has been destroyed by untimely rains. Farmers now face the daunting task of salvaging their harvest. Nepal's Prime Minister Sher Bahadur Deuba has announced that the government will come up with relief packages for the survivors of landslides and floods. The annual monsoon season spans from the end of June till September. However, the late monsoon showers this year caught the Himalayan nation off guard and also killed several people in neighbouring Uttarakhand state in India. And moving on to news from Bangladesh, a gang armed with guns attacked a religious school at a Rohingya camp in Bangladesh's Cox Bazar on Friday, killing at least six people. The sprawling refugee settlements have become increasingly violent, residents say, with armed gangs vying for power.
At least six people were killed in an attack at a Rohingya camp in Bangladesh's Cox's Bazar on Friday, a police official said. The latest incident of violence in the world's largest refugee settlement. A gang armed with guns attacked a religious school before dawn in Cox's Bazar's Ukhia area and killed three teachers, two volunteers and a student, Police Superintendent Shihab Kaiser Khan said. He added one Rohingya man with weapons and ammunition had been taken into custody. The sprawling settlements have become increasingly violent, residents say, with armed gangs vying for power, kidnapping critics and warning women against breaking conservative Islamic norms. A Rohingya community leader was also shot dead outside his office 3 weeks ago.
Loktak Lake in India's Manipur is one of the most attractive tourist destinations in the northeastern state. In a bid to preserve the biodiversity in the freshwater lake, authorities this week released thousands of fish fingerlings in the water body, aiming to multiply variety of fishes.
Loktak Lake in Moirang town of India's northeastern Manipur state is known for its fresh waters and is one of the most popular tourist attractions. In a bid to raise awareness to preserve the biodiversity in and around the lake, every year Government of Manipur organizes Loktak Day. On Thursday, to mark 32nd Loktak Day, Fisheries Department released more than 400,000 fish fingerlings into the pulsating lake, aiming to multiply varieties of fishes in the lake. The majority of the people living around Loktak, which is considered a floating national park, depend on it for their living. However, as a result of mass fish catching, the number of aquatic creatures have been decreasing day by day.
This is a livelihood, and all people are fishing activities on the lake of the Loktak. Then all people are depend on the Loktak. Maximum 99.9% people of Loktak are maintaining fishing activities.
The lake has not only been providing livelihood to the fishing community, but also helps in maintaining the climatic condition of the state, experts say. Loktak Lake was named as a wetland of international value in the year 1990, considering its biodiversity and ecological position. The lake is home to over 250 aquatic plants along with hundreds of varieties of birds.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now, our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/sasianewsline and follow us on Twitter at sasianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time next week. Have a great weekend. Good night.
TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.